Let's talk about 3D printing, which is basically addition of material under computer control in order to create a 3D physical object. And this addition usually takes place in sequential layers, layer by layer, we go. This is called additive manufacturing. So 3D printing technology is is an example of an additive manufacturing technology. And the opposite direction of production manufacturing is called subtractive manufacturing, where we remove material from our disposal. Like we carve out the unnecessary material, we subtract them. And we end up with our desired model, which is a ball in this case. And this is the quick recap of additive manufacturing, where there is nothing to carve around, and we just add layers sequentially. So 3D printing is a hot topic. It attracts lots of attention, especially these days. But we should note that it dates back to 1981, so it dates way back actually. But after 2009, when some patents have expired, it became a hot topic basically. So these patents that have expired were on FDM technology, but indeed the first 3D printing application was using a different technology called SLA, so we will all see them one by one later. But let me talk more about this first work that is known to mankind, which is due to this Japanese guy. It's called Automatic Method for Fabricating a 3D Plastic Model with Photo Hardening Polymer. So photo hardening kind of gives a clue about the technology. Basically, we have this resin to which we expose UV light, ultraviolet light, controlled by some mask of that layer, and then the points where the resin, where the UV light hits, gets frozen, and it gives you the shape, 3D shape basically. So let's be more chemical, at least for one slide, for the sake of argument. So resin was polymerized. What is the polymerization? It is the formation of polymers, like many parts, from monomers, which is a one part. So it can be explained with this slide nicely, not proper, not rigorously, but a monomer is a molecule basically, like this one, this block. It has the ability to bond with other molecules in order to create a long chain. So a polymer is basically a chain of monomers. So here we see that chain. In nature, we have this spider silk, which is known as the strongest natural polymer. It's an interesting fact. And we also have synthetic polymers like confetti that are used in birthday parties. History of 3D printing, so we are still on that issue. Recently, so come to the 21st century, we see car prototyping, we see food printing, we see the implant prosthetic jaw being printed, 3D printed in 2012. We also see some, so this is a prosthetic jaw, like it's just not a organic part of the body. It is just a plastic-like thing that is used for medical purposes. Another medical activity uses bio ink to create bones, basically. It is tested on animals, but still it is a promising area. So let's go a little bit technical. We can see that 3D printing technology uses translational elements in order to fabricate a digital model. So these translational elements are, I count five of them here. So first one is stage or tank. or the chamber where the action happens, where the model is built. Another element, so it is translational because that build plate will go up and down, etc. Another translational element is material deposition nozzle. So from the head, the nozzle, we extrude material. And in bold below, I am writing the corresponding technologies. Like this is fused deposition modeling. So we will get into the technologies later. Another translational element is this laser. So instead of nozzle extruding, pushing out melt plastic or material, we can also use a head that beams, that send laser beams, which are ultraviolet laser or carbon dioxide CO2 lasers. There is also a projector in action in some technologies. So let's begin with the fused deposition modeling, FDM. This is the one that I use in my office. Basically, it was not to make any kind of advertisement, but I was using Altimaker 2 Plus, so it is an FDM technology, which begins by slicing a given 3D model. So I'm talking about technology. I first slice the model into layers like these ones. I can have uniform slicing like here, or adaptive slicing. Like I can skip through the planar smooth regions with thick layers to save to decrease the number of layers, hence to decrease the execution time, the print time. So this is a digital action. Then comes the material deposition nozzle, this one, also known as the extrusion nozzle. It pours polymeric filament, okay, polymeric filament. It melts it down, and we end up with a liquid filament, which gets cooled down with the fans around the nozzle, okay, and this filament gets poured down to this horizontal XY plane, and we build the current layer basically with that logic. So this is that build plane that I'm talking about, or stake, you can also call it that. So this translates, moves down one layer when the current layer is done, basically. And the principle can be summarized with two words: material deposition. So I have a good demo on that, actually. So let's go through these examples here. So maybe I should run it faster. So this is the most important place. So let's begin from here. I am depositing material. So see, this is my nozzle. So what is happening here is you can see that the white stuff is the support material. We will get into that later, but without that, you can see by laws of physics, this gravity pulls this black shape, the object down, which will suck basically. Actually, it will sag, it will have a sagging effect. So that's why we should also deposit structure, support structure when necessary. So now this was the zoom in to one particular region. Now let's zoom out. So the current layer is built basically. So this is the important part. See, the build plate moves down and down as my layers in different colors being manufactured. And then what's happening is, remember the white support structures, they should be removed manually, or maybe if you are using a different material that can be factored out by getting in touch with water or other chemical liquids, then you can also use that. But there is this process of getting rid of the structure material. It can be a very boring and long process, but it can also be simplified, like by using a different support material that can go out by just dipping this thing into a water, a chemical water. But then there comes the question, if you are going to print the support structure with a different material than the actual object, then you need two nozzles, because one is responsible to pour down the support material, and the other is responsible to pour down the extrude the real object material. Okay, so these are all trade-offs, and I think it's okay. So let's continue. So I am moving to the next technology called stereolithography, SLA. Recall, it was 1981 paper, so I am now going through it in more detail. So the technology is from 1981, but it has been improved, obviously. So again, the first step is digital. You slice the model into layers, and then you feed these layers to your 3D machine. Actually, you don't feed them one by one, but the machine processes the model layer by layer. Okay, so here the ultraviolet laser, which is this beam, is directed into our build plane, which is in this horizontal XY plane, to harden the liquid resin or another photopolymer on contact. So when this laser hits the resin, that part gets hardened. Okay. Again, the same idea, state goes down. And again, if we want to summarize this in two words, I could say it material solidification. Remember, FDM was material deposition. So let's also see a video from the same channel. Okay. So what part of that was useful? Okay, this. So I remember a good part of it, but anyway. So see, the laser is hitting the upper layer, and so here is a better demonstration. So this is our laser coming, and through weird mirrors, it is being reflected. See, these are the mirrors, to the top layer of the resin, and then see what just happened here. So wherever I hit, they will get frozen. So it will be solidified. It will be solid, and then I sweep. See? So okay, here the sweeping happens. So basically, I am sweeping out a new layer. Where it gets solidified as well. Okay, so let's see this in more detail. So yeah, basically I am swiping in a new layer where solidification happens. Again, some support structure has been used here to build this fan, and then they get removed, I guess. Yes. Another technology, so SLA was that. SLS is quite similar, selective laser sintering. The main difference is, instead of using ultraviolet laser, the laser type changes to CO2 laser, but actually it was not the main difference. The main difference is in the resin department. Instead of using a liquid resin, a photopolymer, I will be using a powder. Okay, so not a liquid thing. So this powder, but the logic is the same. Wherever the laser beam hits, that part of the powder will get solidified. Okay, again, build plate state moves down one layer when that layer is down. So in the upper layer, I will make a new activity. So this is again can be summarized in two words: material solidification, which I can demonstrate again using the same channel. Okay. Where should the action begin? Yeah, okay, I think. Okay, so here, see, when the laser hits, they get solidified, then a sweeping occurs through the whole layer to create a clean layer. See, so this is an important moment. So see, that layer is done now. I swept. So that layer goes down. So the wheel plane moves down, and to keep everything flat, one sweep occurs, and now I have a clean slate where I can. It's a perfect planar region. There is no protrusion, etc. No cavities. Where so I can now process that layer. So this is a perfect illustration again. See, the plate is going down, and I clean up, make the upper layer planar, perfectly planar, and then it continues. So see, I am dealing with the powder here. Okay, so this is the tank or chamber. So now it will get real as here. The powder, be careful, you will get rid of the powder, and the thing is now this is reusable. Okay, the powder, you can just reuse the powder for another printing, but the bad news can be what? So here it is not the case, because this object is not a closed thing with an empty void, like a ball. Think of a basketball. So if you manufacture a basketball with this tactic, then the unsolidified powder will be trapped inside the basketball. Okay, so it will be there. So this is kind of a disadvantage of this approach. But in this case, this is not closed. Okay, so this issue hasn't occurred. But the best part of it is there is no structure material, because everything is inside this powder. So basically, you can everything is supported by this powder automatically, which is not a different support material, and so you can reuse it again later. So I think this is it. Okay, and the fourth technology is SLA. So we have this resin, liquid resin, and I will, instead of sending laser beams, now I will send the mask, the picture, in one shot. I will project it. So it is called direct light processing based, so DLP based SLA. So instead of a continuous path, a deposition or a laser follows, you project a set of contour, silhouette images with this DLP projector onto the liquid. And then that liquid gets hardened. And again, I can summarize it with two words: material solidification. See the demo of this as well, which does what? So I am, see, this is a perfect liquid. You can see that liquid actually. So why is this still? Yeah, okay, see, the liquid is not hardened at all points, obviously. And this is the projector that I'm talking about. It will project the mask of the current layer. So this is not quite clear here, but maybe we will. Okay, so see, the projection has happened for some shape. Okay, so every the white part of this liquid is not a liquid anymore. It just got hardened, got solidified, and now obviously it moves down, and new layer gets another of that, and now so this is, see the resemblance. This was like that spaceship shape. See that part was the base of this black output for some reason. Okay, so see, this is the end product of that thing. So see, that was the black base of the object being manufactured. And now I can give you another terminology. So raster-based technology versus vector-based. So if there is a continuous path, either extruding the material, depositing it through FDM, or sending the laser beams through SLA or SLS, so it is continuous. Ahead is continuously moving around. This is called vector-based technology. And the DLP-based, it sends, projects an image. So it is called raster-based. Okay, and let's wrap everything up. FDM was using this filament, which gets melt down and then gets frozen with the fans around. So we deposit it through the nozzle. SLA uses resin, which is a photopolymer, and it makes the hardening with a UV laser. SLS uses, instead of a photopolymer, it uses polymer powder. There is powder involved, and a different type of laser required to freeze the powder, because it is different than photopolymer, which requires UV laser. And finally, we have seen SLA DLP, which is again dealing with a liquid resin, and an image is sent. And the machines are quite different depending on the technology. So let's see some trade-offs. Go with the FDM if you want to do a multicolor printing or multi-material printing, because in that scenario you can just stop and change the material for the upcoming layer. For the FDM, again, so I have kind of mentioned this, if you have a closed object with an empty inside, like a basketball, or like many other shapes, like you are printing a toy, for instance, which has only the outside of it, is the surface of it is useful, so the inside would be void, empty, then FDM is good to go. You can do it with FDM, but with the other technologies, the non-solidified material gets stuck inside that closed object. But those technologies are still useful for complex geometries, especially, because in that case there would be many support structure going around. So the removal of them is an issue. It is another cost. It's another material. So FDM is not that good in that scenario. And here I can show you some example. If your 3D model is this, which requires support material for sure due to its nature. So if you print it without support, then gravity sags it down. So there is some sagging effect, which is unappealing. And if you use sacrificial external support structure, you then remove it, and you have your model. New technologies can print out of plane. So far I have shown you a build plate that goes down, so you process it plane by plane. Okay, so you don't go back to a processed plane later, mainly. But we have seen technologies that are doing out of plane, so some plane can be accessed later. So it is more flexible, but then you should avoid hitting the existing part, okay, because you have already printed something below you and you now want to move to those places again. So basically, maybe I should show it with an example. Okay, so see, this is not in plane, so I am doing this plane now and suddenly I come to an. So see, it we are, so maybe it was even more clear in the beginning. So for instance, at this time this plane is done, but now this thing, the nozzle is going below this level, right? Again, so there is a heating issue. It shouldn't hit the existing parts that have been manufactured, etc. So with the FDM logic, deposition of material, why not use the master of deposition, which is the silkworm, the animal? They do this deposition naturally. So I want to show it to you if I can get my mouse here somehow. Okay, sorry. So this was an interesting project. I can't click for some reason. So maybe if we restart like that. Okay, sorry about that weirdness. So this is interesting. The silkworm is that animal, that insect. So all it does is to create this silk by depositing material. Okay, so what they do in this project is they have provided this environment, which is, it looks like a geodesic drone, down to the silk, so the worms. So they gave them this cake. Okay, so they build it. They also put some paths for them to travel, but they don't really fill up the cake. They just do some sparse filling on them. Then they leave the silkworms. They put the silkworms on top of this cake, and then they just go out. They just leave them alone. And these worms, they deposit the material, which is silk, to that cake. Okay, so it is like FDM, fused deposition modeling. And so in the end, this is going to be the result, as you can see. Okay, so a fun project. Okay, so now be careful. Print time depends on print time depends on the part volume in FDM. So the bigger the object you are printing, the more the time you need, obviously. But in other technologies, it depends on the height of the object. So even if your object is very thin, it doesn't have a large volume. But if it is long, it means that you need to, since you go layer by layer, in other technologies, you make the sweep, remember, to create a clean slate for the new layer. You need to make a sweep to make the above layer perfectly planar without any cavities or convexities. So it really doesn't look at your object volume. So we have this constant sweep time required per layer in the other technology other than FDM, so all these three others. So that's why if you are going to print a single small object, then FDM is the way to go. And maybe it is the reason at homes we generally see FDM printers, because at home we are not, we don't go commercial, we don't go industrial, we just do prints for our pleasure probably. Then FDM should be the way to go. Now let's go to the product development pipeline, which is this figure that I took from this survey in 2017. So what does this tell us? We have assumed that the product concept, like I want to deal with this armadillo object, so assume that it is already designed, so it is out of my scope. In this talk, in this lecture, we will do the yellow layer actually. Okay, so the blue part isn't really my concern because the object has been designed without printing in mind. So this is actually a deficiency, and it's also a future work direction that I will talk in the end. So you can keep 3D printing in mind during the design as well, but currently it is not the case. Then comes the process planning part, which is the yellow part. Process planning pipeline. So we will go through each single step, like tessellation, some what we need watertight models, like orientation, support structures, slicing. So we will go these steps. And then the model is ready for fabrication. Then we go to the green step, which is all about mechanics. It is, you have this device called 3D printer. It either deposits material or solidifies material based on your yellow part process planning output. So yeah, okay, so let's go through this process planning very quickly. First of all, you may want to update the mesh to comply with the input representation requirement. In 3D printing, the tessellated geometry must be watertight, meaning that it must like it must not leak any water out of it. Okay, so that is the idea, watertight, a very informal definition. You should enclose a solid. Another part of it was what? So I did this part orientation, support structure. So let's go with orientation. Okay, so you need to orient optimally to minimize the print time, support needs, or fitting into the volume of the printer. So here, let's be clear about this. I want to print this T-shaped object. So it goes layer by layer, as you know. So all it goes like this. So the red pad is the pad of my nozzle. But when I come here, it begins from here to here. See, what just happened is these are not supported from below. So gravity kicks in here and there will be sagging effect like this. Okay, so this will be the output. So you need supports, which is here. So you can go it like this. But if you think about an optimal orientation, you should actually print this upside down. So if you have gone with this orientation, then everything will self-support itself. So you will begin in this with this layer, with this layer. See, everything is, so when you do this layer, there is something below me that supports me naturally. And when I come here as well, so see, optimal orientation is a very important thing. Then creation of support structures is an issue. If sometimes they're inevitable, orientation doesn't really save me. So we will create them. Also, then we will slice the model either uniformly like this or non-uniformly. So non-uniform means some layers will be very thick. So I will just go through that part of the surface in one shot. So sometimes it is necessary for efficiency actually. And finally, so slicing is done. Machine toolpad. So what is this about? It is about converting each slice, okay, to a toolpad. So this is either a vector, like a path, continuous path, or a grid of pixels for your rasterization. So here is a sample toolpad. Basically, G0 means put the nozzle at that location, but don't extrude anything. G1 means extrude, okay, basically. So XY coordinate, so nozzle is at this coordinate, and in the next time step, see X coordinate slightly increases, and I am doing some extrusion, E means extrude, so there is some format with that. So who are interested in 3D printing business, especially the process planning pipeline, PP, computer graphics experts, or digital geometry processing experts also involved. Mechanical engineers are involved. Material scientists are involved. Mathematicians are involved. Space filling issues, etc. So we will see most of them today. So again, let me repeat. PP, process planning, in traditional subtractive manufacturing, such as CNC machining, it is complex. And experience is really necessary. In additive manufacturing, PP is very algorithmic, so you don't need an experience. You should just design algorithms. And also, there is going to be a less material wastage in AM because there's you really deal with the layers, the object parts that you are interested in. So more on AM versus SM. So shapes, a very complex shape like this is made possible through additive manufacturing these days. And it is all because it goes slice by slice independently. So every slice is just like a picture. It doesn't really care. It just fuses material or solidifies material at that slice. So that's why AM can produce very complex outputs. Also for customization, we have AM at our disposal. You can just scan an object or your friend, and then you have the digital model of it, and then you feed that digital model to your printer. But I should note that the geometry processing pipeline involved here is, so from scanner to digital world involves steps like acquisition, so data acquisition, registration, alignment of multiple point clouds, reconstruction of surface from those point clouds, aligned point clouds, remeshing it, smoothing the mesh. So all these steps have been covered in our class, as you know. And we have also covered other steps like what mesh deformation. Okay, so this is kind of an advertisement for our class, like we have covered these necessary steps as well as other steps. So like shape generation from scratch also has been covered. So what is this link then? It is again kind of a, it is my 3D model, texture mapped. So this has been captured in a SIGGRAPH conference, but the thing is, the steps to go to this digital model have been discussed in our class, basically. So I put this as a motivation to learn digital geometry processing. Anyway, so once you have the digital model, we can do the printing of it with additive manufacturing. Also, for multicolor or multi-material production, AM is useful again, because with SM, subtractive manufacturing, the initial material may not support those colors, because you are not allowed to it is not practical to create that initial cube of stack of material with colors of your interest. Okay, so you generally begin with a block of material of the same color, etc. So, but with AM manufacturing, you can change the color at every layer easily. But there are also some disadvantages of AM, like part sizes are limited. You are limited to your camber of your printer device, to the tank of your printer device. Fabrication is slow. You go layer by layer. Okay, materials are necessary. Poor surface finish is inevitable mostly, because when you use a support structure, you will remove it, so it will leave a mark on the surface. It is kind of expensive. Gravity, so the real world, affects the manufacturing. Like, these are called overhangs, or like this overhang. It's so some part of it supports it from below, but these pink guys, they just fall. Okay, these are called overhangs, or islands like this. Again, this cannot just be fabricated without a support. So go with subtractive manufacturing if you need many precise items. So with nice surface finishes and many of them, like fast action, or go with additive manufacturing if you need a complicated models that require a hollow, an empty interior. So with subtractive, again, it is hard to play with the interior of it, because your hands probably doesn't fit inside of the material, so you cannot carve it out enough, etc. So there are issues. But a better approach can be going hybrid. First do your additive manufacturing to get the general shape, and then do some refinement over it using milling, for instance, in subtractive manufacturing. So process planning pipeline can be tuned to optimize for one or a combination of these three objectives: cost, fidelity, and functionality. So cost deals with pre-build cost, build cost, and post-processing cost. Pre-build cost is about turn a design into a set of printer instructions. So I need to create those instructions. To make that, I first need slices. So should I go uniform or adaptive? So that is the case. There is labor involved, like you need to load the print material, the powder, for instance, or filaments. You need to clean your printer from a previous session. You need to warm it up. You need to deal with the software coming with your printer. You need to understand its mechanisms. So there is some pre-processing involved there as well. And during the printing, in the print time, we need efficient algorithms to reduce cost, like an algorithm to fix the to select a good orientation that requires less supports or no supports. Material cost is also a cost for the action time, because during action I will be wasting material, especially the support materials. They will just go out of our life because we will clean them up, we will throw them to garbage. Structural strength may degrade to use less material, so you should have a nice trade-off in the material selection. Support structure amount affects both printing time and material cost. Okay, so again, support structure stuff. I can find out the amount of support structure before printing. Basically, I know this down-facing triangles that don't have any support, so they just face downwards. If I send a volume of prism from those triangles to the floor, then I can compute those volumes and I can add them up to compute the sum of the volumes. to compute the necessary support structure amount. But as far as the algorithms are concerned, I can reduce this build cost by being smart about support structure issue. So for instance, in this case, again, let's get a pen. Normally the support structures are just vertical blocks from all overhanging parts to the ground. But here a tree topology is involved. Basically, you don't use material along this long height. This tree moves beginning with a root. It moves up to a certain point and then branches out to your troublemaker positions. Or you can get inspired from civil engineering, like you can use some scaffold based supporting, like in this figure. And in the post-processing, you need some polishing, like detaching supports. And in that case, chemical, mechanical, or manual surface can kick in. So it is about the cost stuff. So remember, I am talking about the tuning of process planning. So cost issue is that. How about fidelity issue? So this is about this question: how perfect the replica is? So I have the digital model. How perfect is my output? I will have form fidelity as well as texture fidelity. Okay, yeah, so these two stuff. So let's go with the form fidelity first. Difference in shape between design and production. Okay, so what is that? So the ideal shape is this curvy part, and in production I will have this layers stacked on top of together. So I can understand the difference. So this is okay for the bottom part, right? So it is very loyal to the original design. But as I go up and up, so I am really deviating from the original design due to the printing issue. So basically, I can quantify this error by something called cusp height error, which measures the heights, these H values. So it is zero here, here. So it gets a little significant here. So here it is like this. So here it is like this. Basically, to discretize this, what I do is I put this tangent line between two endpoints, and height would be the perpendicular length of this perpendicular line from here to this tangent line. So let's see it in the zoom version. Height is this, right? So L is your thickness of your slice, and if it makes theta angle, so here basically the height I am interested in is the, what is this? It is L times cos theta, because cosine of theta would be L cosine of theta over L will be cosine of theta, right? So H is that, and I will sum all of them up, okay? So this would be the cost in the production, but in the design, I can compute this error before printing. So I know this build direction, right? This is the build direction, and every face has some normal. So let's go with this face. In this case, the normal of this face is like this, okay? And build direction is this, so they are perpendicular, and then their dot product will be zero, okay? So there will be a very low cost, like no cost at all. But as I go horizontal here, so here the normal of the triangle around here is like this. It is quite consistent with the build direction. Then I will have a large dot product value, which will lead me a bigger error. Another option is, so remember I was just adding up the height values here. You can just also add up the volumes in this, in these gaps, okay? So texture fidelity is a different issue. Tiny local variations over the printed surface, so it deals with that. And it can be computed only after printing, so you need the printed surface. It is also known as surface finish. To obtain better fidelity, some smoothing or support hiding mechanisms are in place. So this is called meniscus smoothing, a special term here. Basically, it applies to liquid-based prints, like solidification of resins in your SLA. You lift the solidified layer above to make a smoother transition. A support hiding tactic is this. I want to place supports at the least salient, the less important parts, so that their removal artifacts will be mostly hidden. So if you don't do it, see the removal artifacts are clear on the face, which is an important part. So it can be avoided if you put the support to the back of this person, because what really interests you is mostly the front face. So basically, these are candidate supports that have some quality measures attached with them, and to compute them, basically to find the build direction, you consider some candidate orientations that are that can be predefined, or that can be based on the current convex hull of the input, etc. Then you shortlist or another way to create these candidates are to short this from a regular sampling of orientations. Again, now you use a bonding sphere, for instance. So Let's do more on texture fidelity. Now I will talk about self-support. So hopefully my shape will be self-supporting, but there is a way to do that. So if your shape is this Christmas tree, if you print it in this B configuration, then these parts are not self-supported. So what they do in this paper, in this algorithm, is they decompose an object into pyramids. And pyramid is a special geometric object, right? It has a base and it has an apex. You go through that pole, and everything is supported from below by the base. So if you look at all these parts that make up this final object, so now you can print them separately in different sessions or in the same session, it doesn't matter. Then you glue them up for something. Or instead of gluing, you can also put some cavities and corresponding convexities here to assemble them, etc. So there are ways. Now the last criterion in my process planning pipeline tuning is the functionality. So I want to optimize shape to comply with some functionality requirements. They can be robustness, like stability. I want them to be insensitive to forces. I want the output to be balanced, so to achieve some kind of equilibrium by mass distribution, or I may also want it to propagate light or sound properly. So let's begin with the robustness stability issue. In this work, for instance, what they do is they have this digital model, they know the material in advance, they also simulate the falling effect of this to understand the vulnerable points of it. Then in the output, they give you a probability of failure or breaking at every vertex. They also give you a location of common point of failures. So it is just like a warning algorithm. Another robustness-based functionality is this. So you have this screwdriver, for instance. If this is your up direction, basically your layers will go like this because this is the up direction. So assume horizontalish contours surrounding this screwdriver. So what happens here is you all go horizontal like this. So when you apply even a small force to this guy, it will break at from this point. But now let's think about printing this guy from right to left. Okay, so the up direction goes from right to left. Obviously, it is not up from this view, but you get my point. So if you print it in this direction, your slices will be like this, right? You have this verticalish slices. So especially in this troublemaking region, you have one long vertical slice, okay, and then another, the second one, etc. So what happens is I have one big continuous layer of material which allows me, which makes it more stable under external forces, either known or unknown. So see, this is the amount of force getting applied to this optimized orientation, up-oriented, optimized, nicely oriented printing. So it is more stable compared to the original version. So for this example, for instance, it tells you, it decides on this up direction. So you need to print this guy if this is the up direction. So basically you will print it like this and this, right? So this, you will have vertical slices, which will make the legs very stable instead of the, if you make the up direction like this, then you will end up with this horizontalish slices from this view, and it will make it less stable. So the algorithm depends on detecting these regions, as you can see, because of these colors. Then, based on the orientations of those circles, you will decide your up direction. Another issue, so this is not about robustness, but this is about appealing of your output. So, for instance, you will do an elastic material printing. Okay, your material will be elastic, like you will fabricate a flower or something. So if you target this output, when you fabricate it, when you fabricate this model, this will be exposed to gravity forces, known forces in the outside world. So it will make it sag, right? It will lean towards the floor. So, but in order to end up with this configuration, I will make some inverse computation, and I will come up with this slightly unrealistic model. But it is unrealistic in the digital world. When I print it, when the forces, gravity forces apply to this, it will convert to this pose, which is what I really want in the beginning. Okay, that is the idea. Now talk about balancing. So take this shape, for instance. Don't see the interior of it. So if there is this uniform mass distribution within this model, then its center of mass is probably here, and its projection will not be supported. It will not land on the onto the support region where it touches the ground. So it will basically fall down. It won't stand. So what they do is they just play with the weight distribution inside the object. So the printer doesn't extrude filament for some region inside, and some region they it extrudes, it pours down filament or solidifies material. In summary, it will just make an interesting mass distribution inside the object, which will make it stand. Or with that logic, it can make it spin properly, or it can make it float on the water. So what is the next issue? Still about, not so about balancing, but so this is about keeping a low weight to strength ratio. So weight, I want the weight to be less, so less material, but strength to be high. I still want it to be very stable. So for this example, for instance, this is your object, but it turns out that this region isn't so crucial. So you can carve this part out. Okay. So similarly, most of the part here is just removed out, and you still have the same stability. So it is called topology optimization, a nice research field in 3D printing. About the propagation, so here, for instance, you can make the light propagate in a particular way, again for entertainment purposes, or you can make the sound propagate based on the shape of your outputs. Now, I want to talk about input requirements. So this is about digital mesh processing. So this part applies to our class properly, and it is the most related part of our class actually. So printing technology is for solid objects. So we tessellate. So it doesn't print a point cloud, for instance. What I mean is you need to tessellate that point cloud into a surface, and that surface should be watertight. Okay, so creating surfaces from point clouds, we have discussed that thing on the surface reconstruction class. Also, there are some books on it, so it's a very active research area anyway. So given a point cloud, I can put a surface on it. I can enclose it with a surface with many algorithms. Like there is Poisson reconstruction, I think there is power crust algorithm, and here this is a very easy one basically. So don't see the surface here, just consider that you have points, okay, of this bone. So given a point, you select, find this k nearest neighbor, so you have a point cloud. Then you can fit a tangent plane to that point cloud through PCA, as we have seen in our previous classes, one of the previous classes. Then you have a plane. So you project all the 3D points to that plane. Now they are all in 2D in that plane. So do a Delaunay triangulation that is well defined and very easy to do in 2D especially. Then make the triangulation and lift the result back to 3D. So you have your triangulation. And you do it for all the patches and you take the union of those local triangulations, basically a simple algorithm. Or you can go implicit. So that was an explicit algorithm. You deal with the points explicitly. Implicit algorithms, you put a scalar field around your input point cloud, like you compute your sine distance functions. Again, I discussed this, and then run a Martian cubes to get the surface. But the surface that we deal with should be watertight. Okay, so to make that definition rigorous, I want to talk about a manifold mesh. What is a manifold mesh? It is about keeping things simple. In images, we assume that every pixel has four neighbors, so it is regular, up, down, left, right. Likewise, in meshes, assume meshes are manifold. So just like you assume images are like that, with that neighboring, we can assume meshes are manifold. So this assumption keeps formulas simple and it leads to fewer special cases in code. So one stability, one regularity about manifolds is this: edges are contained in at most two faces. So take this edge for instance, it is shared by one, two, at most two. So it is shared by two, in this case it's an interior edge. If it's an out border edge, it is shared by one triangle, which is still okay because I want at most two triangles. But here, this edge, for instance, it is shared by one, two triangles, the flat ones, and also it is shared by this perpendicular triangle above, so third one. So this is non-manifold. Vertices are contained in disk of triangles. So I have this disk topology for every vertex. So this is the manifold case, but here there is no disk, missing stuff. Or here, this is not disk topology, it is non-manifold. So this is manifoldness. Watertight meshes are two manifold meshes. So 3D point, ND points lead to N-1D manifold meshes. So watertight meshes are two manifold meshes without boundary edges. Without boundary edges. So like this airplane, like there is should be no holes or and no manifold structures. So one good way to think about it is fill it with water. Is there a leaking out? If not, then you probably have a watertight mesh. But you probably have seen prints of this form, right? We can print sheet-like structures. What they do is we thicken this. Like maybe we create an offset of this shape and we connect it with the original shape. So you go from surface to solid. But how about the holes? Due to sensor errors or occlusions, your laser beam doesn't touch here, etc. So there may be some holes and I need to fill it up. Okay, so this is about filling holes in meshes. So there is a paper on this in 2003, which is still in use. It's a very nice algorithm actually. So you can go from this mesh with holes to this output with three steps. First of which is triangulation, a coarse triangulation of this region. So you can detect the border edges here, right? Remember, every edge is connected to two triangles if they are interior. But if it is on the border, then this edge is connected to only one triangle. So go through the edges. If it is shared by only one triangle, then it is a border edge. So you can define your border polygon by ordering these. There is an order. You can just traverse them in order. So you have this border, you have this polygon. And this border is empty, unfortunately. There is a hole in it. So first step is triangulate. that region. So if you have n vertex, you will end up with n minus 2 triangles. So this is just a known fact from computational geometry. I have also talked about this in our in one of our first classes. So this triangulation, I will talk more about it. It will be based on dynamic programming. Then, so I will go to this part. Then I will refine it. Refining means the following. So probably I will have, likely I will have triangles with very long edges because it will be a coarse triangulation. But I know an idea about the average edge length because I have already decided the initial border edges, so I can take an average length from them, and then I can subdivide these triangles. So take a triangle like this, subdivide it, I don't know, by maybe placing midpoints to the edges and then connecting them. So I now have 1, 2, 3, 4 triangles which have shorter edges. So do this subdivision until you end up with the average border edge length. And then you can also do one more refinement, like you can greedily convert this triangulation to a Delaunay triangulation by flipping edges. So the idea is the following. In this scenario, look at the minimum angle, it would be probably this, and then assume that I flip this edge, so it would be this configuration. In this configuration, the minimum angle is probably this, and this minimum is bigger than this minimum, so keep the flip. And do this greedily as long as you can, so then you have an even better triangulation with nicely shaped triangles. But it is still not enough, so you will probably end up at this part after the refinement. Then you need to smooth these things up, so some mesh fairing will happen to push stuff to obtain your original smoothness, obtain your original curvy nature here. So let me talk more about the coarse triangulation part, okay, because it is the heart of this algorithm actually. So I will minimize in my triangulation, so in this triangulation, okay, I will minimize area sum plus maximum dihedral angle. So consider the following. So I will give a weight to each triangulation. So let WAC be the minimum weight or cost that can be achieved in triangulating the polygon from A to C. So if this is in my pocket, then the final output will be based on W0. So go from the first vertex to the last vertex. And to get there, the intermediate steps will be filled as I go there. So and the computations will be stored in an array. So this is the idea of dynamic programming, as you may remember. So you don't recompute. But those details aside, let me show you the action with some figures. So let's, at an intermediate step, you want to compute W to 9. So I want to triangulate this region from 2 to 9. Remember, I have this polygon, so I have this ordering of edges. So I will go from 2 to 9. So what would be the best triangulation here? Would it be like this? So the cost here can be the cost of this triangle. I will talk about it later. Then the cost of triangulating this region. So this is one option. Or I will use this triangle, which is 2, 4, 9. And the cost of triangulating the left region and the right region. So right region goes from 4 to 9, for instance. Or another option. The cost of this triangle, so be careful, I am just shifting the triangles one by one. Cost of this triangle, 2, 5, 9. Plus cost of triangulating the left-hand side, which is a sub-problem that has already been solved, so I know the value for this. Plus, again, the answer for another sub-problem, which goes from 5 to 9. Or, again, I shift. I was here before. Now I am here. Cost of this triangle, 2, 6, 9, plus cost of triangulating this polygon or this sub-polygon. Or this triangle, again, shift one more. Plus cost of triangulating this region plus this region, or finally cost of this triangle plus cost of triangulating the left region. Okay, so among all these options, which is finally here, I will select the one that minimizes, that is the minimum. So let that be this one, okay, this rows, which corresponds to this case, I think. So I will keep this triangle in my life, and recursively, this part has already decided on its own triangle. So that's why they already have some triangulation. So now the issue here is, I promised to talk about, is this fact. What is the cost coming from a triangle, not a triangulation, because a triangulation is handled by this W tactic. So the cost of one triangle, I can simply use the array of ABC for W. So for this term, for W259, I can use just the array. Then, since I am minimizing this mean, I will end up with a minimum array triangulation, which is okay. In if your missing part is planar, but it is not okay in general. So here is a problem. This is, assume that this part, I want to fill up this part, okay, and it should be like this, right? So just a spoiler alert. But with the minimum array triangulation, you don't end up with that. It will favor this crenellation or spike. So crenellation is like coming from castles, these spike triangles. So they will be duplicated, because since I will minimize the array and nothing else, so I will get this array, and for the above part, I will duplicate. So this is the original triangle, and now the original triangle is here, plus the triangulation has already created a second triangle on top of it. So it will be non-manifold also. There will be duplicate of triangles on top of each other. Not cool. But it will be minimum area, because in this case, see, the area has slightly increased. This area is longer. Because to get the minimum area, instead of going to this layer, they have used these areas actually, right? But it is not a good result. So what the paper suggests is, instead of only area, you use minimize area. Okay, it's a good tactic, but also use minimize the maximum dihedral angle. So what is that? Dihedral angle is basically the angle between two triangles. So if my hand is one triangle, it is not, but anyway, these two triangles are adjacent ones, okay, where edge is, so let's quick it like this, they are connected by this edge, right? So there are configurations. So if they are planar, then the dihedral angle between them is zero. Very nice, because what is that? It is, so normals are looking at the, okay, from my palm to the outside world. So it has this normal, this has this normal. Two normals are like this, they are very compatible. So basically the dot product of them would be one. Remember, dot product is projection of this vector on top of this, and take that length of that projection, which is one, everything. So to get it one, the theta, the dihedral angle should be zero, because cosine zero is theta. So here I have zero. But in the duplication case, what happened is this: one triangle is here looking at you, and one is looking at me. So they have opposite normal directions. One is like this, and one is like this. So again, when I dot product this to this vector, I will project it like this, and I will take this length. But this will be minus one, because it is in the opposite direction of the original direction. So how do I get minus one? I need 180, a very big dihedral angle. So I minimize it, so I prevent this. Or another bad case, so this is a good case. So this is a dihedral angle of 90 degrees, okay? How do I end up with this? This normal looks at you, and this normal looks to my left. So I have this normal versus this normal, and they're perpendicular to each other. So when I dot this vector on this vector, so projection of this onto this vector is zero, like it just projects to a point. Length of a point is zero. So how do I get zero out of this dot product? The angle cosine 90 is zero. Okay, so then the angle is 90. So I am minimizing this angle. So I don't want 180, I don't want 90. So I am going closer and closer to zero angle. So in other words, I am minimizing the normal variation. I want all normals to be close to each other, which is the case here. Okay, so that's why it's a very nice algorithm. Yeah, so let's talk more about the shape. So this was input requirement. How about the shape? So the shape should fit into the chamber, into the volume of your printer device. In my Ultimaker 2 Plus in my office, it has this volume, like it is from my neck to my belly. So it doesn't really take this care in one shot. So you can segment them. One algorithm, one research direction is how to segment them. Also you can partition models, like from coarse to fine. So there are methods. Another related issue is the arrangement of these parts into a container to be shipped somewhere else. So it is related. So you have to put shapes in a box, related problem. Shape interior is a key factor regarding material use and print time. So if the material is increased, then print time increases. They are very correlated. So there is a positive covariance, if you remember the covariance days. When one is increasing, the other also increases. Okay, so the interior is a very big issue, because consider a cube. When you double the size of this cube, so it has three dimensions. So when you double the size of the cube, all the dimensions get doubled. So I have three dimensions, 2 times 2 times 2, 2 to the 3. So the volume doesn't just double, it goes 8 times larger. So this explains the interior's impact on material use. So if you decide to double the size of your object, like this object, the volume of it will not just double, it will be 8 times longer. So this is one issue. So you should be careful about interior manipulation. Also, you can achieve elasticity using different interior structures. So the same amount of force is applied to this shape, which has a denser interior structuring, and also to this shape. So this gets affected more. So this is more elastic. And this idea can enable you to build elastic toys without any joints. And you can also print them using inelastic material, fabricate them. Thanks to the interior structures, they will be elastic. So coming up with the correct interior structure, sometimes there is a family of interior structures, so you need to interpolate from one to another one. You need to make smooth transitions between different microstructures. So these are all research problems. And another thing about shape interior is, we will probably fill the inside of the shape, okay, as we print that layer, okay. So there are, if you are talking about a raster device like DLP SLA, then it is not an issue, because you just produce an image and you are done. But with the vector device, where your nozzle follows a path, even in the in the contour of the object, or if you are infilling it, you will also go inside of the object as well. But in any case, this path, this head will traverse a path. So what would that path look like? We will go with something called Fermat spiral. This is a recent discovery, and it is interesting that Fermat has lived in the 17th century, and now we are in the 21st century, and it has found an application, this spiral. So, what is the issue here? With this is a traditional direction parallel space filling, the head movement algorithm, where we have many sharp turns. Sharp turn means motion should be slowed down to make that turn. Also, it will cause some vibrations. So sharp turns are not good. I can avoid them using this contour parallel tactic. So see, there is only four sharp turns, which is acceptable. But this is discontinuous. So when you finish this outer layer, you need to shut up. You need to stop your extrusion. So stop, and then come move the nozzle head here, and then restart. So you have this stop and restart thing, which is again causing you a loss of time. So this is also not that good. Hilbert curve has many sharp turns, just like here, as you can see. So Fermat spiral is continuous. See, it starts here and ends here without any discontinuity. Also, there are many few sharp turns. So they have shown you how to fill the interior of shapes in this work. And finally, I will give you some project topics for this class, or in general for 3D printing business. It can also be, they can also be considered as open, important open questions for future work. So, can we design shapes with the additive manufacturing in mind? I ask you. So far, 3D printing algorithms work on a 3D shape that comes, that is downloaded from somewhere without any AM in mind. And then they try to deal with that shape, that model. They try to orient it, they try to self-support it, maybe segment it to self-supporting parts, etc. So they really work hard on it. So instead of doing that, why not just consider AM in mind during the design? So it is printer friendly. So this is one thing to consider. So for instance, another way of considering this is, I want to create this dinosaur. If I model it like this without any printing in mind, then I will use an excessive amount of support material. Depending on your technology, it will still be a lot in SLA. But I could have designed it like this, like deform it a little bit more to maybe support structure is inevitable, but you can minimize the amount of support. So you just use this version of it, print this one, and if you are really into this pose, maybe you print it elastically and then you deform it to this pose by hand. Or maybe this pose is already okay for you, and in digital application this pose can still be obtained. You can go from this pose to this pose easily. We have discussed mesh deformation algorithms, many of them, as rigid as possible deformation, for instance. So you can check those slides. Okay, so this is one good example of AM in mind during design. Another thing can be putting structures onto the surface. Okay, so not filling the inside using Fermat spiral or something. Currently it is still done like manually, or you use some curve primitives, define curves on this shape. But you can, one idea can be use existing faces, polygons on the shape, and extract patterns like oxetic patterns from the models. And finally, I can suggest 4D printing, not to the whole world. Obviously, this is something being done actually, but I can suggest you to look on this new area, which is 4D printing. So the idea is, you will, it is an interdisciplinary work with material engineering. You will have these metamaterials that are able to morph into a target shape after being printed. So this is the printed, fabricated output, but depending on the material and this initial pose, this material will have the shape, will have this particular shape at this particular time, for instance. Okay, so a user may want a particular shape at a particular time, then you need to make your initial printing and select your material accordingly as well. So you need to decide on your initial printing pose as well as initial printing material properties to reach to that desired state in the given time. Okay, so with that, I will stop. Thanks.